All right, this is a big story. A whistleblower in Chile's clerical sexual abuse scandal, which was huge, covered up, and disgusting. All right, so one of the victims goes to talk about how they became a survivor, goes to meet Pope Francis, spends days at the Vatican. Then Pope Francis says something that we have never heard from anyone in any position of authority at the Catholic Church, let alone a pope before. He says, God made you gay and loves you that way. Your sexuality doesn't matter. If you're Catholic or not, you would never expect to hear anything like that coming out of the Vatican. Juan Carlos Cruz is the man you're about to meet. He's the man who traveled to the Vatican. He didn't need to. He's got his own life as a survivor. He's a corporate executive. He's doing well. But now he is in the middle of something that so many never expected. And it is a pleasure to meet you. So let's give context here, okay? You are a grown man. You are living a full life. You work for a huge company in a big position. You do not need to dwell in your teenage years, the hardest moment of your life, but you decided to go to the Vatican. Why?
Well, you know, it's been a fight of years. Me and two of my friends who spoke up in 2005, some 2009, it was something we had to do. We had to stop this predator from abusing more people. Friends of ours had committed suicide. I mean, it was time to stop him. We went to the cardinal in Chile, Cardinal Errázuriz. Nobody believed us. Nobody did anything. You know, when you think the abuse is bad, you should see what it is when bishops re-victimize you and slap you across the face when you think they should be the ones, you know, helping you.
So you went to them and said, look, here's what happened. We've heard of another case. This has to stop. It went back many years ago.
Yeah.
Enough is enough. Now, not only did you meet the resistance of the church as an institution, which we've seen, but because you were a gay man,
yeah,
there was another layer of scrutiny. What did they say to
yeah.
you?
Yeah. So when my lawyer, we got a lawyer who's an amazing man, and we were talking to him, and then he told the other two, hey, when you leave, I want to stay with Juan Carlos a little bit longer. And he said, Juan Carlos, I hope you know what you're getting into, because by being gay, they're going to go after you like you cannot imagine. And, you know, when your life, I wrote a book, and I say when your life goes by, when you're going to die, they say your life goes by. That's what happened to me. I had ran away from Chile to come to the U.S. and work here, and had built sort of my castle. I work with the media. I'm not the news. I make other people news. And so it was really hard for me. But I said, okay, I'll do it. And as I did it, and immediately the cardinal, for example, started saying, Cardinal Errázuriz in Santiago, who was the archbishop at the time, said, Juan Carlos Cruz is not a victim because he's gay and he liked it.
Oof. And so, all right, so wait, let's give people context. Man, that makes you, especially for the Catholics, man, that's hard to hear. Somebody that you put in a position literally of reverence saying something like that. You're a young teen. You lose your father.
Yeah.
Where were you in your life at that time and what happened?
So I was in high school and you know, I was so broken and I thought, I come from a Catholic family, not you know, a normal Catholic family. And they said, some friend of the family said, go to this priest, Father Karadima. He's incredible. He's a saint. He's, you know, he'll help you. And I did. And so, of course, you know, predators are like that. You know, they, friends of mine, nothing ever happened to them. And to me, yes, and to others, yes, right? So it was you, yes, you, yes, you, yes, you, no, no. You know, it's so random, and they know how to do it. And so the abuse started shortly after, and it's so embarrassing, Chris, for a survivor because, you know, I consider myself a semi-intelligent person. I, as you said, I work as an executive on one of the largest multinationals in the world, and you know, head global communications brand. I do all these things. And to think that when I was that age, not 4 or 5 or 6, I was older. And to have myself let myself go through that is something that it's hard to forgive yourself.
You were young,
but I'm
you
trying.
You were vulnerable, and that man knew it, and he took advantage of it.
Yeah,
and the only thing that we know as fact that is impressive isn't what you succumbed to, isn't what you were able to survive. It's that you made it through.
Yeah.
And look at where you are now.
Yeah.
And you go to meet the Pope. And how was he with you? Did he believe you?
Yeah, so in January, we've been accusing a bunch of these bishops of cover-up, right, in Chile. So he went to Chile in January, and he didn't expect what happened, that very few people went to his masses, very few people were excited to receive him in Chile. They gave a holiday, and instead of people going to see the Pope, they went to the beach. Mm. Something wrong was there. And at the last day he was in Chile, they said, well, what do you think of Juan Carlos Cruz and James Hamilton and José Andrés Murillo, my two friends? And he said, what they are saying is calumny. He said,
calumny, false blame,
yes.
That this was all untrue, because that's what he had been told by the people in charge
exactly,
in Chile.
Exactly. So, of course, everybody was in an uproar. We were in an uproar. We spoke up. You know, I remember the New York Times editorial board doing a piece supporting us and how. And so shortly after, he sent the Archbishop Scicluna and Monsignor Jordi Bertomeu they came to New York to interview me because I'm the only one that lives here. Well, I live in Philly, but I'm here all the time. And then they flew to Santiago, and they did this whole investigation and went back to the Pope and told him, Holy Father, you were wrong, and they misinformed you. This is after 70 people we interviewed. It's true. And so then he issued a letter that summoned the whole bishops' conference to Rome and called me and the others and invited us to spend a week with him in the Vatican in his house in Santa Marta, because he doesn't live in the Apostolic Palace. And I actually lived in the room right under him, and it was incredible. And we had hours and hours of conversation. And you know, after last week, the bishops' conference came to Rome, and they all presented their resignation.
You say that the story that we've been told, which is they voluntarily resigned,
oh, no.
is not the truth.
No.
That the Pope put the arm on them and said, you're all
yes.
out. I'll give you the
yes.
dignity of resigning,
yes.
otherwise you're out.
Exactly.
Important distinction. What did it mean to you? I want to end on this. When you saw the Pope look you in the eyes, and we know what the position of the church is, right?
Mm-hmm.
That being gay is some kind of function of disorder. We love the sinner, but not the sin.
Right. Right.
That's what you expected, I'm sure. When he looked you in the eyes,
so I was sitting like I'm sitting with you and just by ourselves, and it was a conversation that ended up being like almost 3 hours, but it started with him saying, I really apologize for the pain that the church has caused you and for what I've caused you. I said, Holy Father, no. He said, no, let me finish. Yes, I caused you pain by saying this in January, and I want to apologize, and it was sincere. And then I said, you know, that they had painted me in such a perverse, that I was just this perverse. And I said, Holy Father, I'm not a saint, but I certainly want to be a good person. And he said, Juan Carlos, God made you like this. God loves you like this. The Pope loves you like this, and you should love yourself. And for me, of course, tears, you know, and so it's been incredible since. And, you know, more so for the survivors around the world, because this doesn't have to be about me. It's about thousands of survivors that are suffering right now, that do not get heard, that are not heard, that are treated with disrespect. And so I feel by firing this whole bishops' conference, by us being there, by him listening to us, maybe this is the beginning of the end of this culture of abuse and cover-up by bishops, and that this Pope is not going to stand for it. And so, and on this other subject, it's been incredible the amount of gay people that have written to me and said, I'm crying as I hear this, and it's touching. So I hope that by me doing these things, it helps survivors, it helps gay people, it helps all these people that are disenfranchised and that are suffering in some way, and that I can contribute to bring them through this great man, the Holy Father, to bring them some kind of solace in their lives.
There will be people who don't like it. There will be people who will hate on you. There will be people who will explain it away within the church. And none of that matters because the Pope said something that their church and that the world needed to hear. Being gay is not what you do. It's who you are. And he said that for everyone to hear.
Yeah. Juan Carlos, Chris.
Don't thank me. Thank you for telling your story here.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Allison.
What a profound story and impact that it will have. Let's talk about love, shall we?